Okay. I welcome everyone for the day six session. Today we are going to discuss about the climate data analysis tool. This tool I'm using since 2010, like more than 10 years I'm using this tool. Let me go to the website. This is their website, okay, climate data analysis tool. Now they renamed it to community data analysis tools. Previously they used to keep it as a climate data analysis tool. And this is this library is developed by the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, USA, that also sponsored by NASA. One of the NASA project is this CDAT project. And using this, what all things we can do? First, let me go to the gallery session. So that will give us an idea what is the use of this tool, which we are going to learn for the next 5 days. So by looking at this website, the gallery, you can see that this is a 3D cube. You can rotate it. We can create a three-dimensional globe, and then you can see circulation. So this kind of images or animation can be created. And this is a 3D multi-plot, which is a cross-sectional. You can do the cross-sectional. Like this is the bottom, you can see that world map, and this is a pressure level. At particular cross section, you can cut it and see how this three-dimensional plot can be done. This is camera angle that you can rotate it. And similarly, you can see the multi three-dimensional plots gallery, you can see it here. Like even three-dimensional wind vector can be plotted. And beyond that, as usual, normal two-dimensional or mercantile projector, like latitude, longitude, just a normal or for a publication, how we used to plot it. Similarly, we can plot it at different color scale and streamlines, as well as wind figures, everything can be plotted. You can see that ISO lines, ISO fields. This is the El Nino stuff based on UAF mode. Or instead of map, and this is just a regular two-dimensional without base map, you can plot it. Or line plot, multiple line plots is there. And box plot is there. Box plot is like each and every grid will be plotted independently instead of smooth or isofill or iso lines. This is the box plot example. And this is a pattern based. If you want to plot with some box fill pattern, say for some significance over a particular region, for that we can use this kind of template. Like this is the pattern. There are multiple patterns available so far, like more than 12, like I think more than 48 patterns are available that we can use it. This also again a simple fill color, or you can customize your own RGBA color. So this can be done. This is just one of the part. All this visualization is the end. That's the end product. But before that, we have to cross many steps. First thing, we have to read it. We should be able to read the our NetCDF file, say for what are the data format available in weather and climate community. we should be able to read it, and we should be able to write it in the same format. So using this CDAT library, we can read the self-describing files, such as NetCDF files, and GRIP1, GRIP2, HDF4, HDF5 files. Also, you can read ASCII files that we have seen yesterday itself. But using this, we can write only in NetCDF file format. We can read from multiple file format, but we'll be able to write only in NetCDF format. So I mentioned that today I'll be showing demo on installation, but as of now it is not possible because I have some internet disconnectivity to my HPC. My office HPC having some internet issue. So today I'm not going to show demo on how to install. Moreover, NCMRW of my HPC already pre-installed this library, but still I want to give demo on how to install. Maybe in upcoming classes, like tomorrow or day after tomorrow, I'll schedule this how to install. If you go to our website, if you go to getting started and installation, So first of all, we need to install Anaconda or Miniconda. I would prefer to install Miniconda rather than installing Anaconda, because Anaconda having thousands of package which we'll never use it. Miniconda would be sufficient to install this. Once we install Miniconda, then the installation is very easy. Just a single line we need to follow, like this. Conda environment create -n environment name and -f and this file. This file, any one of them, from here we have to download. Like in Linux, Windows, or Mac OS, Python 2 or Python 3. So one of them we have to download, and then we have to run this command. It will be installed. That's it. However, I will show demo in upcoming classes. So today I'll just discuss about getting started. I'll give introduction to the arrays and variables before getting into deep into the climate data analysis tool in terms of I'm not able to maximize. So today I'll just show the demo and explain about arrays and variables. Then tomorrow onwards we'll be discussing more about there are some modules available in climate data analysis tool, specifically for more in terms of statistical analysis or regrid or interpolate. Those many things are there that we will see tomorrow. Before that, we have to understand two-dimensional or three-dimensional or multidimensional array, how we are going to handle. Based on this, only this climate data analysis tool being the wrapper has been written. So first we have to understand this, then tomorrow onwards we'll go in deep into the CDAT. Yes, then like we will be discussing about what is an array and the NumPy package. Like we can create the arrays and array index, array queries, manipulation, and what is inside the CDAT. We have something called MV variable or masked variables with the meta information. And we do have GUI for the CDAT, but the latest version right now it is not available, but it will be available very soon. You can cross check in their website either it is available or not, the GUI, but I never used a GUI. And this presentation is made by my professor Krishna Achyutarao. So I'm just adapting this presentation. I'll be going through this. So in Python, we do have some package called NumPy. Previously it was a numeric. It used to call it as a numeric and numeric Python. Then later on they changed it into NumPy. So this is just like an array or like a list, except that all elements are of the same type because they want to make the operation much faster. Yesterday and day before classes, we have seen that in Python, we can create a mixed list. Like you can put a integer, float, string. So this kind of mixed list we can create in Python, but in NumPy, it is dedicated. One array should contain only one data type. Either integer means only integer, or if it is float means float, only double means double. Just to make sure that the operation is much faster. And multi-dimensional arrays are more clearly supported. Also normal array operation also can be done. So it's a standard package available in Python. Not only CDAT and many other library like iris and xarrays, these three are the main thing to access climate data or weather data, to access with the meta information. CDAT and iris, then xarrays, these three. The next five days, we'll be discussing about CDAT and iris. So how we are going to utilize this NumPy, just we need to do import NumPy. This is the syntax, just we need to import the NumPy. I'll show the demo right now. So we can create arrays using NumPy, just import NumPy. They say some variable A is equal to numpy.array. This is the syntax, numpy.array. Then open parenthesis. Within that, whatever array you want to create, we can pass it as the argument. Here, it is done with the two-dimensional. So let me try. So once we install Conda, then we can list out what are the, we can create a multiple environment. So I'm going to choose what I installed. Once we activated, you can see that previously it was base, now it is CDAT 8.1. My entire Python environment has been changed. Is that visible in YouTube? Okay, fine. I'm going inside. I just imported NumPy. I hope this font is visible. Let me say that this works or not. Okay, I'm able to copy from PDF. So I just assigned this. See, oh, I just imported NumPy. Then I'm assigning to some variable initializing with some value that's called a. A is equal to numpy.array, open parenthesis. That's a function or method. Within that, I made one array or list. Then list containing two elements that also list. So first list containing these three values, 2, 3, -5, and second list containing 21, -2, 1. So when I'm just accessing this A, it shows a multidimensional array. Suppose we can do A dot D type. It's a data type. So it shows that integer 64. Which means a double integer, it consists of, like in Python or in any other language, we do have something called integer 32, integer 64. So it's this is 64 long integer it can occupy. Suppose if you want to change this into float or double, there is option called here. While declaring, while creating, you can pass the argument, second argument. D for double. So it's double means a float 64. If you keep now it has that, though we entered integers here while creating, the list is integer, but we made the argument D type as a double or float. So now this data has been created with a float 64 data type. You can see that it is a floating point. You can see that. So we have some predefined type codes, D for double precision floating and F for single precision floating. Let's say F32 and I for integer, L for long integer. Suppose if you want to create some initialize with zeros, always in Fortran we used to do that. So let's do that. See this, I'm just initializing zeros, numpy.zeros. Inside that we have to give the shape. At what shape we want to create the or initialize the arrays with the zeros. Suppose if you want to create one more dimensional. Now you can see that it is having three dimensional. So this is the topmost, this array, and it's ending with here. And it contains one set, it is having 2x2 elements. This is also 2x2 element, this is also 2x2 element. Let's see if we have pressure level and latitude longitude. Suppose three pressure level and two latitude and two longitude. So this would be the shape of our array or time dimension. If you want to create time dimension, then we can create. Let me go with 4. So you can see that. So four times this will be created. 3, 2, 2 or 3 by 2 by 2. So you can create a dummy arrays like this. Whatever the shape you want to create, you can create. Say, if you want to create some numbers, yesterday we have seen like a range or X range. So we can go with this X range or A range. So it contains 0 to 9. Suppose if you want to go with like a 1 to 20 by 2, this also will work. If you want to go with a point, floating point, so now it's being generated with the floating numbers. In default Python, it is not possible. It will just create as an integer only, but in NumPy, you can create with a floating point operation also. So this is the step between each and every numbers. So I kept 0.01. So it has created these many numbers, like 90 numbers. You can create whatever step interval you want to create. You can create, say, 9,000 numbers. It's just generated. I'll tell about this. So as usual, once you created NumPy, or once you access this NumPy, you can access it using A(0) or A(1), like we have seen yesterday's. It's the same as list concept. Like we have seen, even the -1 that will access the last number. So again, let me go to this example. So we can access A(0), A(1), A(-1). A(0) is this, and 1 this, and -1 just coming from the backward. Suppose the question is, what is asked if A(1 to 4). So what will be the answer? So we already seen that always Python array start with a 0. So NumPy also having the same procedure. So this is 0 and this is 1. So it's starting with this 1. So 3.2 will be printed. And this is 2, index 2, 0, index 0, index 1, index 2, index 3, index 4. So this will be printed up to 1, 2, 3 only, because in Python we have seen it is always n-1. So let me do this. As I mentioned, just let's go start from 3.2, 5.5, and -6.4. So 1:4. This is just one dimensional. So suppose if we have multi-dimensional, then also we can do it. Let me copy this one. So this is my array. A is like, what is the shape? We can get the shape, just A dot shape. Shape is 3 by 6, 3 rows and six columns. Column 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So three rows. The first row, second row, third row. So now what is A of 1, 2? So there is one more option called comma also, we can use it. So this returns this value, this 4. One, the first one is the first row wise, and then comma gives the second option, which column you want to access. Let me explain more clear. Now A of 0 returns this array, the first row, and A of 1 returns the second array. So within that second array, I want to access some second index. So if suppose I'm accessing of 0, it returns 1. This one comes from here. Now 22 now. This. So if I want to access the 4, then we should mention what is the row and what is the column. It starts from always 0 and ends with n minus 1. If n is the maximum of your row length or column. Is now he is asking like a A. So here I'm just accessing the first index row. This I'm going to access, comma, colon. So colon means it just empty colon means it just bringing everything. Okay. Suppose if I want to access only up to 3 elements. Now it's just 0, 1, 2. So colon. If you want to more clearly explain, this is the implicit. So 0 is implicit if you are not giving the starting index. 0 to 3. So first column I'm accessing, sorry, the first index column, index row, first index row we are accessing, that's the first argument. Then second argument, we are within that, from where to where it has to bring the content or elements. Suppose if I'm changing to 1, 2, 3, then it will be just 22 and 4. Suppose if I'm not giving the second argument, like 3, I'm just removing entering. It's just bringing everything starting from 22 here. Starting from 22 and just bringing whatever it contains up to the length of the array. And let us go with this example. So what it is bringing? It is bringing this 1 and 22, also 3 by 3 and 1. How we are accessing? Yeah, 1 to 4. Because this is 0, 1, 2, and we don't have fourth column. Yeah, fourth row, but still it didn't throw any error because that's how the number is designed. If you are giving extra number or extra length, it will not return any error. It will just return whatever it is possible. If it is not possible, then only it will throw error. So 1 to 4 arrays, and then the column is 0 to 2. So this is a zeroth column, 2, 1, 3, and this is the first column, 3.2, 22, 1. So this within that we are going to we are accessing this 1, 22, and 3, 1. So we have to understand clearly about array accessing or array indexing, then only the future classes will be easy to understand. So what's the use of this accessing index? Suppose if we have any like a version data at say for SST, and that SST we should not give value over the LAN, so we have to mask over the LAN. So we should know the correct exact lat long, or we should, though our library using lat long coordinate, but internally it has to get the index. Using index only we can keep some values like true or false or zeros or ones. So accessing this kind of index is essential. We should understand very clearly. You have to practice yourself, then only you can understand. Once you understand, then it will never, you'll never forget it, the concept of array accessing. Then NumPy have some more features. Say numpy.shape, you can get the shape of the array. We have seen it already. Let me show you one more time. This is 3x6. Original array is 3x6. While accessing, we are indexing through some of the index like 1 to 4 and 0 to 2, and its shape is 2x2. Suppose if I'm overwriting this, A with A is equal to A of this, then it will be overwritten. Now, because we are deleting that omitting that variable A, and then again reassigning the 2x2 value or array into that again A. So previous, this array has been removed. This array has been removed from the memory, and the new array has been assigned to the A. You can get the rank of the array. Also, you can get the size, NumPy size. NumPy size is just a number of elements, 4. Either you can use numpy.size and then we can use the parse the array that also returns, or a.size. Similarly, a.rank. Attribute functions of rank matrix. Okay, I should use this one, matrix rank. So the rank is being deprecated. Instead of that, they have moved that rank into the linear algebra. That's another module inside Python. Within that, they are calling it as a matrix rank. Once you get it, then you can pass this into the our interesting variable that is returning the rank. Yeah, now we'll go into the numpy.reshape. This is the most essential thing which we should learn. We'll just go back to my just copy paste it once. So we know that the shape is 3 by 6. 3 by 6 and 2 by 3. So we can change this into different shape. Right now this is 3 by 6. So 3 by 6 is 18. So we can change into different shape. Let's say 2 by 9. So 2 by 9 also 18. I mean 2 into 9 is 18 and 3 by 6 is 18. Now you can see that. So I just reshaped it, this EA, with a different shape. But make sure that multiplication of this array element or shape should not change. Otherwise it will throw error. So what happens? This 6 elements retained here to 2.4. Then from 120 to 4 has been moved here as the first row. And then from here, 0.1, 5.3, minus 9 kept here. In the second row, first three numbers. Then the remaining numbers are being kept followed in the second row. So similarly, you can do the reshape at any shape, but make sure we are the multiplication is, or the shape is consistent. Suppose if I'm changing to 6 by 3, now you can see that. So 2, 3 by 3.2, 5.5. Then this become the second row. This is third and this is fourth. This is fifth and this is sixth. You can see it here very clearly. So you can do it, like say B is equal to A dot reshape. Like this also you can do it. And within that I'm pausing 6 by 3. Now the A value will be reshaped and stored into B, but A shape will not change. You can pass one also, because that is not going to change your multiplication anyway. So the one is the first dimensional, or you can call it a Savarpressel pressure level or time dimension, whatever way you want to call, you can consider this. Suppose if you're introducing this one in between, then you can see it very clearly. This is the topmost element that is having six arrays within that first level, that is here. First level is starting here and ending it here. Then it contains three elements or three columns. This, so you have to work on yourself to understand this NumPy concept. So once you understand this NumPy concept, then you can utilize many functions in Python. SciPy also based on this NumPy only. So you have to understand this very clearly. We can do transpose also. Let's do this. So right now A is 3 by 6. Now I'm just transpose, like a matrix transpose, we can do it. So now the columns becomes rows, rows become columns. That's a transpose. This I can store into B. You can see that 6 by 3. Instead of 3 by 6, it has become 6 by 3. And you can use this function to flatten. Flatten means like the multi-dimensionality will be removed and everything will be treated as a single dimensional or single array. See this, previously B shape was 6 by 3. Now I'm just storing it to C dot shape. It's just 18. We have seen that C, just it's just removing the multi-dimensionality and then just keeping it as a single dimensional or single array. You can also do repeat. This is A, and I'm just repeating the A 3 times. So what happens, this individual numbers being repeated, you can see that first number, 2 being repeated 3 times, and 3.2 repeated 3.2, I mean 3 times, 5.5 repeated for 3 times. You can also specify the axis at what dimensional you want to repeat it. Let me give 0. So the first 0 means 0th axis being repeated, which means this is the 0 dimensional. So this is repeated. Instead of previously it was repeated like every element repeated and next to next, instead of that I kept the first axis wise, this entire axis or this entire row repeated 3 times. If I give 1, yeah, by default it took 1 that we have seen already, because it is having 3 by 6. Suppose if I want to repeat that entire shape as it is, this entire content I want to repeat with the same procedure. So what we have to do first, we have to reshape it. I'm just adding one more index axis. Then I can do the repeat. See it now. Now the entire row or entire matrix has been repeated 3 times. This is 1 time and this is 2nd time. This is 3rd time. So previously we have seen example for just repeating the numbers as it is, because that time shape was just a 3 by 6. So when I give 0, the first row, like a row wise, it is repeated and kept next to next. If you want to repeat the entire 2-dimensional array, then we have to make it as a 3-dimensional by giving the first dimension as a number 1. Say for again, I'm just repeating A dot shape 1, 3, 6. Previously it was just 3, 6 or 3 by 6. So now I just mentioned 0. Axis 0 means this is the 0th axis. So with that axis, we are repeating 3 times. So we can do convert also. You can do type conversion also. You can do. Next, yes. Now, like there is an example to multiply 2 matrix or 2 arrays, and element by element we can multiply. That's the example as here it is given. The question is like multiply 2 arrays together element by element, not dot product, just element by element we want to multiply. How in general, how we supposed to do? Just we are importing NumPy, then we are getting the shape, to get the what is the shape or get the number of rows or number of columns that we are getting it here, storing it to shape comma shape underscore a. Then in general, what we used to do, first we have to like initialize the output variable with the zeros. The same shape we are keeping it, initializing with zeros. Then suppose if you have two arrays, a comma b, what in general what we used to do, like for I in x range or range, shape of the first index, then for j, x range, suppose both are having same shape, then the column wise we are going inside the for loop, then products. Like this is how we used to write in Fortran or any other formal language. Every index we are accessing, a comma j star b comma j, that is the resultant multiplication product will be stored at product of I comma j. Let me do this. So this shape is having let me just make sure I'm assigning this. So I just assigned A. What is the A? A is this, and B is this, and A shape is, so that itself shape only 2x4, both are 2x4, and product is we just initialize with the zeros. So we can do this for loop, inner for loop. Then copy it properly. Indentation is required. So now it is done. It is done with the multiplication. So now the result is, this is the product of A comma B. It's just a element by element multiplication. If we don't know the inbuilt functions of NumPy or the power of NumPy, in general, we can write like this, but this is inefficient code. So without loop, we can do this. Just a simple multiplication will do that. This is A, this is B. Now product is A star B. It's just multiplied. So NumPy has that facility that will take care. We no need to do this kind of looping stuff. So that's the power of Python and NumPy. Suppose if you want to do dot product, then we can use NumPy dot A comma B. So it is throwing error because it is not proper shape 2x4 and 2x4. Like it is throwing error like in dimension 1 not equal to dimension 0. Suppose what I'm doing, I'm doing the dot product where A dot shape is 2x4. Then I'm just doing B dot T, that is transpose. T is a transpose. So now this shape is 4x2. So it was throwing error just because both are having same dimension. So this is a dot product. You know, we know that the matrix dot product, how it used to calculate. So we just did the dot product. So it become 2 by 2. So similarly, you can do the add operation. This is A, this is B. You can do A plus B. You can do A minus B. You can do even A division. Individual element will be divided. This everything is done with element by element wise. And this is a faster than loops because NumPy, it is written in C. Basically the core program is written in C, and it is, they have given facility to call in Python. So it's much faster. And it will call the appropriate function. If it is a larger array, it will call different algorithms. If it is smaller array, it will call the different algorithm to the computation. So by this way, NumPy is much faster. Okay, 5 more minutes. I'm going to show one more example. Okay, now the question is like, say you have 2-dimensional array A and you want to return an array to the answer, which is double the value when the element in the A is greater than 5 and less than 10. And output should be 0 when it is not. I hope you understand the question. Suppose you have 2-dimensional array called A and you want to store some of the modified output into the answer array. The condition is if A is greater than 5 and less than 10, then double the value. And if it is not, just keep it as 0. This is the question. So how we can do if you are just writing with a for loop? We are just initializing with the NumPy. Like answer, just NumPy dot zeros. We are initializing the same shape as A. And then we are loop throughing the first row wise. So we are getting for a high in X range, and then just this is the length of the array. That's a first row count, and then for a J column count. Then if A of J, a particular A of J element is greater than 5 and same element less than 10, then we are assigning to the answer A of J, just A comma B. Sorry, A star B, we are multiplying. Otherwise, pass. There is a keyword called pass in Python. It will do nothing. So suppose if you want to declare some block statement, but without assigning any statement, you can use the pass. Pass is the keyword or command. It will not do anything. It will not, it's just do nothing. So I'll just repeat this. So I'm going to do this. So now it is return answer. It's just a multiplication of A and B. Sorry, whenever greater than 5 and less than 10, only that is being multiplied with the B. So here 5.5 is greater than 5. So this is the only element contains greater than 5. So only this element being multiplied. So instead of doing like that, in NumPy we can do many logical operation in a single command. Suppose A, you have some A is a two-dimensional array. You can do operation just greater than symbol. So this will just contain true or false. It will just return contain true or false. See this, A greater than 5, it just returns the true only to this element, rest everything is false. And here one more, true. So only these two are greater than 5, rest everything is false. Or you can use this kind of function also, numpy.greater. This also returns a similar results. We can do logical operation, logical and logical or, it's a predefined function available in NumPy. So what here we are doing here, we can write this same question. We are writing the condition numpy dot logical and, where A greater than 5 and A less than 10. So the question is just double the A. So what we are doing, just doubling the A. So there is a function called numpy.where. The first argument is condition. This is the condition where this is the logical and A greater than A and A less than 10. The two-dimensional array true or false being multiplied. And the return answer is stored at condition. That condition we are passing. So wherever the true condition is there, what do you want to replace? So we are replacing with the A star 2 and rest of the place we can keep with the 0. So previously it was 5.5, now it's just a double it. Suppose if you want to keep minus 1 instead of 0 everywhere, you can keep minus 1. Everywhere would be minus 1, only the current answer is being multiplied. So this kind of needed, or this kind of need we'll be have frequently using in our data science. Suppose masking the LANDSI, or if you want to mask El Nino or La Nina cases where it used to have 1.2 degrees Celsius greater than the consecutive anomaly days. So that region, we have to get it like this, and then you can do the mask or replace with some different values. So this kind of logical operation is, we have to understand very better. So you have to do exercise on this, then you'll understand the much easy functionality. If you are doing like this, instead of utilizing the where function or condition, it will be very tough to do when you are accessing multidimensional. Here I just showed the two-dimensional array. For two-dimensional array, it's fine to do the loop like this. But if we have really large array, like our entire weather data or climate data, entire global data, we have to utilize all time dimensional. So it will be very tedious if you are just loop throughing. So once you understand all the functions in NumPy, surely you can utilize it. And the next array, you can do. Yes, here what they're doing. Yeah, instead of one and instead of true and false, they are assigning two true and false. Instead of zeros and ones, logical and a greater than 5, less than 10 is the condition. In a single line, he is writing it. So this is much, much faster. NumPy is much, much faster rather than if you are loop. So try to avoid loop. So we should never ever write loop until it is necessary. All the NumPy operations, all the multidimensional operation, you can do it in a single line or at the most two lines using NumPy inbuilt commands or methods without using any loop. Just remember, you never utilize the loop. Try to utilize the existing functions or existing methods in terms of accessing this multidimensional array or any manipulation. So arrays in NumPy, we have very basic functionalities like you can do sine, exponential, interrupt, cos function, tan function. You can call all the mathematic function in NumPy multidimensional. Also, we have basic statistical methods, correlation, histogram. You can find the histogram using NumPy and Hamming filter and FFT. These everything is available. If you want to access more help on, just do help of NumPy or help of any particular function, you'll get it here. Suppose help of NumPy, it will just return the very detailed documentation. It is having more and more functions, methods. So instead of that, suppose if I want to understand what is histogram or how to use it, I can do numpy.histogram within the help command. It just returned the help function. So we can pass A and then bins. What bins range we want, or range, either do you want to normalize this data before computing histogram, or if you want to pass weights. Here they have mentioned the detailed arguments. So you can go through this. If you have any function, any doubt, or any inbuilt methods, you always use the help in Python shell itself. You no need to search in the internet. So it's already 5. Tomorrow I'll just show a demo on reading multidimensional text. Suppose if we have ASCII file with the numbers that we can read it in NumPy in just a single line. Suppose if you are reading it in program, then we'll be reading like this. Just yesterday I showed you, like, you can read it text file or CSV file. We can read it with a for loop. But I already mentioned we should try to avoid the for loop. So in NumPy, there's just a single line command that will read your entire CSV at any particular latitude, sorry, any particular rows or columns, or within that you can, while loading itself, with you can subset the ASCII multidimensional or multi-column text numbers. So it's already 5. Today I'm just finishing this. Tomorrow I'll just show this exercise. Then we'll jump into the climate data analysis tool. Like, I'll be showing demo on reading, possibly installation. Then subsequently I'll read the NetCDF file, how to read it. Then I'll show how to access the variables. Then in detail, I'll be showing how to, while loading, how to subset the time dimensional or level or latitude, longitude. Then the final day, I'll showing how to do plotting using CDAT. And finally, pre-last day, we'll discuss about iris. Then last day, we'll discuss about what are all the Python tools we are using in NCMRW for what are the products being generated using Python. I'll be showing this. I'll come to question session just in 2 minutes. If somebody has written question, then Just reloading and okay, somebody has to please give. Yes, this was wrong thing in the slide, because that slide contains already previously EA. So that was the thing. This slide contains the subsequent of from the beginning of slide. Madam has asked doubt in this. Like a shape A. But these two lines should be below this A comma B. After this A, this line should come. So I'll give some questions. Maybe I'll send through email. You can practice that. And I guess nobody asked question in this Etherpad. Okay, I think somebody has some question. Just 1 minute, just loading. Yeah, somebody has like, as you are aware, there are a lot of data visualization software programming languages are available. Some of us may feel comfortable in certain language. My question is, how a beginner or Python would know which library or preferred function to import before doing certain operation on arrays? For example, NumPy does a lot of mathematical calculations. So answer to the question is, so before jumping into, so here my role is just I'm showcasing you that these are all possible functionality. So using this, once you get interested into that, you have to learn by your own, just to go to like numpy.org or NumPy website. You just only one time you have to read the documentation and do the exercise. Once you come to know what are all the methods or functions available in NumPy, you don't need to remember that. That's my logic. You don't need to remember all the functions available in Python or in NumPy. You have to just exercise only one time. Then whenever you need it, surely you will come to know that, or you will think of it, this some function is available already in Python. So again, you will go back and read the documentation, then you will implement it. So my suggestion is just read only once and do the exercise, all the Python basics, and in our case NumPy, just do the all the basic operations in NumPy only one time, then you will remember whenever you need it. Then again, that time you will search the internet, then you will get the correct syntax. By this way, you can learn much more. This is how I'm following. And next one is a float object cannot be interpreted as an integer. This I will answer later because I need some more examples. Please give your program code here, then I'll reply it here. So today is 5:15, so sorry for delay. I'm closing this today's session. So tomorrow onwards, we will discuss more about the climate data analysis tool. I thank everyone. Please ask question here if somebody having more doubts. Thank you.